Good evening, everyone. We are going to get somewhere tonight for sure. Thank all of the viewers here giving me the opportunity to work hard and sharing this clarity, because you learn by teaching. That is really true. We talked about in the last video, we spoke about the extreme importance that you are pre-qualified. Pre-qualified, okay. Now we're going to start out here by looking at some of the barriers to accepting this. I say everyone has perfect access. Everyone is pre-qualified to experience the perfect stillness. Everyone, without exception. And therein lies the trouble that we have experienced. We know it's there, don't we? We know it's there, but we hesitate. We don't allow ourselves this gift that we have. It's over there in the corner. And we just don't open it up. It's like we have a Christmas tree, all the presents. We open all the presents. There's one over there. And we just looking at it, just saying, I don't know if I want to open that present. Why? Because it's literally the key to your freedom, to your bliss, your happiness, peace of mind. There's this unconditional love that is simply present right now. Always present right now. It's not engaged in any process. It's perfect, flawless, right now. It will always be so. So why do we not avail ourselves of this incredible opportunity? Very simple. There may be a whole host of plausible explanations, but let's take a look at one that's a very strong one. And I believe it's holding us back perhaps more than any other. There may be some that we don't deserve to have perfect access to this pristine, immaculate peace and love that is present right now. We may believe that we deserve it, but there are some we don't want them to have access to that because there are quote-unquote enemies. Or they did bad things, etc. So we're thinking, you know what, if I have perfect access and this love is unqualified, asks for no qualifications from anyone, that means that this person that I can't stand, that they have the same perfect access to it too, and they're already pre-qualified too. Terrible. How is that possible? Doesn't seem just, does it? And so we make it hard on ourselves because we want it to be hard on someone else. We put qualifications on ourselves because we want someone else to have to jump through hoops too. We refuse to accept the fact that it's unqualified, unconditioned, no requirements. Everybody is already qualified to experience this. And as a matter of fact, they cannot be disqualified. It's impossible to be disqualified. And that's what burns us up. And that is why a spiritual teaching, for instance, A Course in Miracles, says that forgiveness is the key. What does it mean by forgiveness is the key? It means that one cannot ever accept the unconditional love that is present right now as long as one is trying to put conditions on it for someone else. because then one will not recognize what is there at all. Because what is there, it has no conditions, unconditional. It is simply present right now, not 10 minutes from now, not any time at all. So there's no time for anyone to be disqualified. And it's always been so. And we all have someone that we resent, and we feel like it's not fair that they have the same access that I have, right? And that's why we all miss it. And that's why we have so many teachings, so many paths. We've made these paths and these teachings in order to, based on the belief that it's only just that there be some sort of process of qualification to weed out those who do not merit it, right? To weed out those who should not be qualified in our eyes. So this is an enormous stumbling block. It's a fatal stumbling block for us, literally. It leads to our death. There's no death in unqualified, unconditional love. No death there. It's not dying. This effect is not dying. If we experience that, death is over for us. And yet, because we want death for someone else, we also are claiming it for ourselves. Because the reality is one. There's no fragments at all in reality. But one experiences, all must experience. If there's death for one, there's death for all. And when we wish death for one, we're wishing it for ourselves. And we will believe that it's possible. If we experience this unqualified, unconditional love, we will know there's no death there. And whoever experiences it will be free of death as well. And we think, you know, that I remember that person, that someone, those people over there, you know, they don't deserve eternal life. They deserve to taste death. And so we cannot hold both unconditional love as an experience and still believe that somebody else is automatically going to die. We will see that they literally have the very same capacity to experience what we're experiencing, and that they can be free of death at any instant. And we're actually radiating this truth to them, you see. There's no other way around that. So what we try to do is we try to grasp this mentally so that we don't radiate this freedom to everyone. Very few have actually radiated this freedom to everyone. And we'll take a look at one of those right now. This is my teacher, Sri Ananda Mahima, who truly did radiate absolute freedom, deathless freedom and bliss to everyone without exception. And so in seeing this, I realized this condition is truly possible for us. She insisted it was. The only thing that's holding us back from being in this condition, the only thing, is that we're rejecting this condition. We're rejecting it because we don't want someone else to experience it. And in our experiencing of it, we will have no barrier to anyone else experiencing it. Sri Nanayama had no barrier in her towards anyone else experiencing what she was experiencing. Guaranteed. She wasn't saying, well, I deserve this, but there are some who don't deserve it as much as me. No. She would say, her attitude was, everybody can have this right now. And there, I put up no barrier no discrimination, no distinction whatsoever to anyone, ever. Because she realized that all are guiltless in the eyes of God. All are guiltless. God has pre-qualified everyone. Why? Because no one has ever attacked reality. We've tried to attack reality, but we've never succeeded. There are no laws contrary to reality. We've tried to make laws, but they've not succeeded. So you see all these insane ones who are trying to make laws, trying to disqualify themselves from reality, trying to become prime creator, trying to forget what they are. They haven't succeeded in actuality at all. Zero. So where's the guilt? There is none. So where is the basis for anyone being disqualified from remembering what they are, remembering reality and functioning as they were created to function? There is no disqualification, no merit to any of that. No justification. Zero. Zero justification for it. So if there's zero justification for it, then isn't it justified for us to also to go ahead and accept our own freedom and to see this fact? The only way to be saved is to see from the perspective of reality. The perspective of reality is that no one is guilty of anything. Because only reality is real, and reality has never been harmed by anyone. So what is the basis for guilt? No basis. And this may not sink in right away, but these are the types of considerations. This is where your hearing needs to be at. Not in other details, but on the big total picture, the totality can be talked about directly. And that is we're guiltless. There's nobody that isn't pre-qualified. You take the worst person who ever arose in existence, they're pre-qualified exactly the same as we're pre-qualified. Pre-qualified means we don't have to do anything to qualify anybody else. Think about that. The burden is off our shoulders. We keep thinking we need to save someone. We don't have to save anyone. Everyone's already saved. Everyone is already pre-qualified. There's no barrier to experiencing unconditional love, unconditional perfect peace, perfect stillness. The perfect overlay, the effect that is not being modified, perfect stability. There is no barrier whatsoever, zero. We just wish there were a barrier for some, not for us, but for some. But if we put up a barrier for others, we're putting up for ourselves also, because we are one with them. And then we will have to try and jump through those barriers ourselves. And we find out that this is very difficult. In fact, it's impossible. And that's what causes us all the difficulty on the spiritual path. We're trying to qualify ourselves based on the barriers that we are putting up for others. And it's not to judge ourselves over this. This is just a fact. Now, some will say, well, others are qualified, but I'm not. Same thing, isn't it? You're still saying that you have a barrier that others don't have, because maybe you think you're a terrible, terrible person. It's the same thing. Either way you look at it, it's exactly the same. Meaning, there are barriers for some and not for others, which means we cannot see, we're not looking at unqualified, unconditional love. We're not seeing it, we're not experiencing it. If we experience it, we know it has no barriers. You see? And we're afraid of that. We're afraid because we feel that somehow we need to be the gatekeepers. We need to judge others. Judgment from the perspective of the ego makes sense. It's logical. Judgment from the perspective of reality makes no sense at all. It's illogical. It's insane. What is there to judge? Who has harmed reality? That's the question. The answer is no one. So why judge? Why judge at all? Why judge for what purpose? Unless we want to be the gatekeepers and the organizers of the path and the stratifiers, the those who serve some type of corporate path, that we need to improve ourselves and others need to repent of what they've done, the bad things they've done. They need to apologize. There needs to be reparations, you see. There needs to be legal alterations. We have so much work to do to be fair, to be equal, all these things. That's all from the perspective of the ego, entirely. Okay, so this is good news, isn't it? We don't have to do any of that. Because everyone's already pre-qualified. And if they're rejecting that, it's because they either feel that they are better than others or that someone is better than them. Neither one is true. Everyone is already pre-qualified, 100%. Without conditions, unconditional pre-qualification. Love is the presence of unconditional love is simply here right now with no restrictions, no barriers. For anything, anyone, never will. Because it cannot be harmed either. Just here is a gift. And its purpose is to remember what we are, that's all. And it works perfectly well for everyone. So you take the most malevolent entity in the history of the universe, and when they choose to experience unconditional love, they will remember what they really are just as well as we will remember what we are. It'll be just as simple and obvious for them as it will be for us. And what they remember is that they're spirit and are invulnerable, and that spirit and reality can never be harmed in any way. That we've only been tilting at windmills, trying to forget what we are, so that we can be prime creator. But it seems, from the perspective of the ego, it seems intolerable to practice this sort of unconditional love and forgiveness. It seems intolerable, because surely we say there are those who have done terrible things. And, you know, very overtly, there are also those who have done many quote-unquote terrible things covertly. And if you start looking into it, you find out that existence is a vast conspiracy of an attempt to attack God, attack reality, attack what we are, attempt to forget what we are, attempt to destroy what we are, attempt to replace what we are with us as prime creators. And that everybody is immersed in this wickedness and treachery and blackmailing and overt and covert activity, all designed in this way. We think that the great murderers, you know, mass murderers in history, genocide and all the stuff, that they're the worst, you know. But there's probably many that are much worse than that, who set the whole thing up. It's a wicked, wicked world, okay. But from the standpoint of the ego, therefore, you'll never ever arrive at justice or fairness or equality, etc., etc. I mean, just the inequality right now is just endless. The injustice is endless. The more we try to bring justice, the more injustice we bring to the world. The ego is on a futile path, and it knows it, because its purpose is delay. And trying to seek equality is a great way to delay, because it overlooks the fact that equality is already present. We all have equal access to experiencing unconditional love. Perfect stillness, perfect peace beyond understanding, oneness, seamless oneness. We all have equal access to that right now. Everyone on this planet. Everyone throughout the whole universe. Everything throughout the whole universe. The entire universe has perfect access to this right now. And each and every moment is exactly the same. So where is the injustice? Where is it? From this perspective, there is none. Okay. And a great teacher radiates this fact. There's no instability in this vision. You see this vision totally stable. Not drawing differences where there are no differences. Not saying, well, I see, my vision sees one who is qualified, and my vision sees another who is not. And therefore I have to make arrangements for this one, treat this one as special, and this other one is somehow has to do something, and I have to figure out how to help him. No, this one radiates complete certainty that all are pre-qualified and that nothing has to be done to make this so. Therefore, no actions need to be taken. Nothing has to be done. Absolutely nothing has to be done to qualify anyone. There's no one that's not qualified, so what has to be done? Is there anything that needs to be done? Do you need to go as a missionary somewhere and help the poor heathen and qualify them? No. Everyone is pre-qualified. And I know this may cause a shock to those whose life has been based on believing that it's up to them to qualify others. But what they really are doing is they're simply telling others that they are pre-qualified if they understand it properly. We can go around and tell everyone, hey, everyone, you're pre-qualified. You're already have always been that way. You cannot disqualify yourself. If we go around telling everybody that, then that's legitimate missionary work, isn't it? But we're not doing anything to help them qualify. We're just telling them and reminding them and say, you know what? Everyone's pre-qualified. And a teacher such as Sri Anandamaya Ma, everyone who met her felt that. They said, oh my gosh, I'm qualified. I'm pre-qualified. They felt that. And they looked around the room. They said, everybody else here is pre-qualified too. I feel that. And they came away with this great sense of unconditional love, which is basically saying I get the feeling everyone's pre-qualified, because they catch that feeling, they get it. Now, of course, it fades as they say, well, wait a minute, you know, I don't know, there's some, you know, group over there that can't possibly be as qualified as I am. And, you know, then they lose it. But at least they're getting a sense of it. If you get a sense of it, you feel you love everyone, meaning, and you realize everyone is pre-qualified. And it's impossible that they be disqualified in any way. They never will be disqualified. And this is very crucial. In other words, you don't have to go around trying to ensure that others don't disqualify themselves. You don't have to go around saying, you know, everybody, you got to go to church, you know, every day. Otherwise, you might disqualify yourself. Or you've got to study or meditate every day. Or you can't do these wicked things, you know, you can't participate in the reptilians' plan of global sacrifice. You can't do that, otherwise you'll disqualify yourself. Not true. You know, the reptilians here can do whatever they want to do. It won't disqualify them. People can help them get their ego trip through all sorts of sacrifice and death and all of that, but that won't disqualify anybody. You don't need to cure anyone of anything. Nobody's sick of anything. They're just trying to be prime creator, so they're on an ego trip. They're not sick. The perfect love, unconditional love, is present for them right now. 100% quality. Completely stable. So how are they sick? They're pretending to be sick. We're all pretending to have no access, but it's just a pretense. A great teacher will see through the pretense. They see through the pretense. A true teacher will see through that pretense. You see? And that teacher will just laugh and smile. Knowing that everything that everyone is doing to try and qualify or disqualify themselves is complete folly, and love is still right with them, closer than close, present, already present. So what can they do but enjoy that, what they're seeing? They enjoy what they're seeing, because what they're seeing is reality, from their perspective of reality, that everybody, love is with everyone. Unconditional love is already with everyone at all times, at all moments. Never leaves them. Even in the catastrophes that come here, the turmoil, and the terrible things that you would say from the perspective of modification, you'd say terrible things are to come here. Now, Ananda Mayama was here during World War I, during World War II, during the Korean War, during the Vietnamese War, and other atrocities, genocides and atrocities throughout the planet. And that smile and that bliss never left her for a second. All of that was completely untroubling to her. And people would ask her, how can you be so blissful and happy like this, and perfect happiness and serenity radiating this to everyone, when over in Europe there's this incredible, horrible conflict raging, and also in the Eastern Theater, World War II was also equally horrifying. And she said, no, I see it. I see everything that's happening. But she says, you know, one friend is pretending to strike down another, and they pretend to fall down, and then they rise up again, and they strike the other one down, and she says, it's just a game. They're just playing a silly game. But unconditional love is present with them right now, always. Never for an instant did she lose that perspective at all. So I'm telling you that teachers like this are incredibly valuable for us. And we see, wait a minute, you know, there's people outside the ashram who are lying in the gutter, starving to death, dying. The people are dying of cholera and malaria and dysentery, and, her husband died of smallpox. There are people, you know, just horrible misery, starvation and death and all types, just ravaging the people all around your ashram. And here you are sitting in bliss like this. How's that? How can you do that? You know, how can you be happy? And yet she remains exactly this way, exactly happy. And we say, wow, this is really amazing. Well, how is this possible? We realize she's not deluded, because she's completely clear and lucid, absolutely helpful in every way, not crazy at all, but... So we say, how is it possible? Now we see. Why? We need insight into this. It's not enough to go see a guru. It is, you must have insight into their condition. And it's been granted to me to have insight into this condition through working on it for a long, long time. And now I can see why the gurus are this way. Why is she this way? When all tragedy all around. You know, in India, the tragedy is right there on the street. I mean, she was there when the partitioning happened in East Bengal. Terrible rampages happening all around. She was there in Calcutta also, when there were a lot of troubles there in India. When the independence of Pakistan took place. First there was the partition of Bengal into East and West, and then there was the full Indian independence from Great Britain, England. And that was a terrible situation also in many places. And never did she waver for an instant in radiating this absolute certainty to the world that all is well. And how could all not be well if perfect, unconditional peace and love is there for you to experience this very instant, and each and every instant, and you're completely pre-qualified and there's zero barriers, and never will be any barriers for you? How could that not be a great thing? How could you not be happy? If you see that, how could you not be happy? So really, in this world, you have to choose either to be blissful or miserable. That's it. There really isn't anything else we can do. We either see it from the perspective of reality or from the perspective of the ego on reality. Denial of reality. In a denial of reality, we can never be happy. But from seeing existence from the perspective of reality, we can't help but be blissful. That is a fact. That is an absolute fact. And this unconditional love is perfectly stable. It's always that way. It never, even if we reject it, it doesn't change. Someone might reject a guru and then come back years later. The guru is exactly the same. Was completely unaffected by any rejection or unaffected by criticisms of any type. So these are the truths that we have to establish as of primary importance to us, which is what we are doing here. That what satsang does is it establishes what is of primary importance to us. And of course, this is quite different than what the world will present to you, what your education will present to you. You can only imagine what it was like for me to go through the educational system of this world. Absolute hell. And I fought it, you know. Fought it tooth and nail, but I lost temporarily because I said, hey, everything you're teaching here is not of primary importance at all. And they just said, you know, said, who is this? Who are you to tell us what is important? That's the reaction I got across the board. And they said, you know, you got to qualify yourself. I mean, who are you thinking that everyone's pre-qualified? We don't need to do any of this. We're already pre-qualified. All we need to do is accept it. No, they said, oh, no. You have to be educated. You have to learn all this stuff. You have to qualify yourself. You have a long road to go. And these other people, all these poor, uneducated people, we have to educate them. And you have to lift the world up. You have to make an impact on the world. You have to help qualify others. You have to make sure that those are qualified. Don't backslide. And did a disqualification. We have to build, you know, this great system of helping everyone qualify. And I said, this is all complete nonsense. And I said, legally, I had to go to school and sit there in these classrooms where it was a complete waste of my time. I knew everything I needed to know by second, third grade. Reading, writing, and arithmetic. Got those very quickly. I said, okay, I got it. That's it. That's enough to function here for just fine. I went as far as 1 year of a university, and I saw at university everything's exactly the same. It's no better whatsoever. And I said, forget it. You know, that's it. That's enough. It's a waste of my time. It's a waste of everyone's time. We're already pre-qualified. Everyone is already pre-qualified. And if we look at it from the perspective of reality, we must be blissful. And we must radiate this certainty to everyone. Everyone. Effortless radiance. It's not a ray for you here and none for you over here. And people don't like that. They say, wait a minute. I feel I deserve it, but those over there, how come they're getting the same radiance of unconditional love that I'm getting? That just doesn't seem right. You know, maybe they'll think, well, you know, I have advanced degrees. You know, I went through college and then I got my, you know, advanced degree. Then I even went on higher than that, and I've written books, published. I've given seminars, I've done all these things, and how in the world can that, you know, street sweeper over there be just as qualified as I am? That's crazy. Crazy talk. But it's true. And the fact is, as we spend all this time trying to qualify ourselves, we're wasting time. And you bet it's better to hear it sooner than later. It's better to hear it now than later. Okay? You simply have to admit that, you know, yeah, we did waste our time. However, the time that we did doing that, now we know it is a waste of time. So we redeem our efforts that way by realizing, aha, now I know I didn't need to do any of that. But before, I didn't know that. So there's no reason to get angry at ourselves or at anyone, because as we were trying to qualify ourselves, we were caught in the dynamic of the ego and our own desire to be prime creator, and we wanted to pursue this pretension, and therefore we were caught in these dynamics thinking that we have to reject this unconditional love. And how do we do it? By believing that there must be barriers and must be qualifications for it. If we remember, if we experience unconditional love, we will remember what we are, and we will know that we're not prime creator. We can never be. So the ego has to trick us into not experiencing this. So it has to say, yeah, it's there. Okay. Because the ego has to admit that there are some who have shown this to us. So the ego says, yeah, it's there. But you need to, you know, there's a lot of qualifying you have to do in order to get there. And so you don't experience it. Meaning, and then not experiencing it, you don't remember what you really are. You remain completely vulnerable to all the ego's tricks. Let us go over this again. You have a perfect teacher here, meaning one who is viewing existence from the standpoint of reality and radiating stable bliss and certainty to everyone, like a sun radiating without exception. And plenty see that, many see that, and they say, aha, there's something there. And then the ego says, uh-oh, this is trouble. And the ego can't deny it, that it's there. The ego will say, yeah, sure it's there. So you need to now start figuring out how to qualify yourself for this. So right there, we're off the tracks. We've lost it. We're in delusion. We've chosen delusion instead of truth. We've chosen to look at it from the standpoint of the ego instead of the standpoint of truth. From the standpoint of truth, of course, it's totally simple, completely understandable. Everyone is pre-qualified. From the very beginning, it wasn't that there were some that were not qualified in the beginning, but through great efforts they have now become qualified. It's not that way at all. That's the ego who says that, because the ego says that, then you accept that. As soon as you accept that, then the ego's got you right where it wants to. The ego will say, yeah, Sri Anandamayi, she's so great, and she really worked out her karma, and she was able to qualify herself. And you'd think, oh, wow, And the ego say, yeah, you can do the very same. So get to work. Or you might use Jesus too. They'll say, you know, Jesus, he was able to qualify himself and you can do the same. Or any variation on that. But as soon as you accept that some have to qualify themselves, maybe you can say that this one was pre-qualified, but that you're not as good as they are. The ego will say that. The ego will say, like, Jesus was pre-qualified. He didn't have to do anything to qualify, but we have to qualify. That's the ego. That's the lie. Jesus came to say, we're all pre-qualified. God is love. Unconditional love is present right now. There's no barrier to it. And Ananda Mahima radiated that out to everyone for 86 years here, during all the turmoil of the 20th century, without a single swerving away from that. Not an instant did she ever swerve away from that. And simply saying to us, you're pre-qualified right now. You don't have to do anything to be pre-qualified. And of course, you'd say, hurry up, and realize this. Hurry up. Clear away all your delusions so you can realize this. Yes, of course. We, as long as we follow the ego, we will be full of delusion, full of excuses. And we might say, oh, okay, but, you know, what mantra do I need to do? How can I, you know, qualify myself? Or I feel like I've really disqualified myself in some way, so I need to make amends. I need to get rid of that bad karma, etc. Bad karma is really just believing that you're not pre-qualified. That's all it is. That's all that bad karma is. All the efforts you've made to deny what you are. And in order to deny what you are, you have to believe that you're not pre-qualified to experience unconditional love, because that will remind you of what you are, that you're not prime creator, you're spirit, prime created. So you have to avoid it. Really, existence can be said to be just a avoidance. We're all wandering about like crazy ants, trying to desperately avoid finding the sugar bowl, you know. The sugar bowl's there, and the ants are going everywhere in the kitchen, but they're not going to the sugar bowl. And you have to say, it's very strange. And then one ant goes to the sugar bowl and says, hey, goes back and says to all the other ants, hey, there's a sugar bowl there, come on, and it's great. And the other ants go, oh, no, we have to find some other stuff first. We're not qualified for that sugar bowl. So they're avoiding it. We're avoiding experiencing this unconditional love, peace, stillness, quiet, silence, great space, pure consciousness, pure awareness, seamless oneness. We're avoiding experiencing that because that would remind us perfectly of what we really are. And as soon as we remember what we are, there's no way we can believe we can be something other than what we are. And we will know that we were created by the prime creator, so we cannot be prime creator. So our pretense would be gone at that time. So as long as we want the pretense of becoming prime creator, we have to avoid experiencing this unconditional love. We have to avoid it. And even when we come across someone like Sri Ananda Mahima, we might say, yeah, that's great, but I can't do that. I have to do something first. I gotta do a lot of stuff first. I've got to get rid of my person. I've got to heal my personality. I've got to heal other people's personalities. I have to, you know, do the right social work, and I have to do the right charity work, and I have to do all this stuff, and boy, I've got a long ways, long path. I'll get there eventually, but boy, it's a long path. I better get going on that. And then we are gone into the ego's lair. We've walked back into the ego's lair entirely. And we stay there for a while, and then we realize, why, gosh, I really haven't made any progress at all. This is crazy. You go back to the teacher, and the teacher's the same, and you say, oh, yeah, something strange here. I mean, teacher, can you help me? How come I don't really feel any closer to this, and I don't really understand it yet. It goes like that. Spiritual path goes back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. We're not really getting anywhere, but we're getting closer to realizing we don't need to do anything. We don't need to do anything for ourselves or anyone else. From the standpoint of qualifying ourselves or qualifying someone else, from the standpoint of preventing ourselves from being disqualified or preventing someone else from being disqualified. None of that is in play. Of course we can still do all the charity work and good works and all that. That's not a problem, one way or the other. But it has nothing to do with qualifying ourselves or qualifying anybody else. And if we make our charity work the radiating of this certainty to everyone else, then we are truly doing the utmost that anyone can do. As this teacher did, she did the utmost that anyone can possibly do here, which is give perfect, seamless radiance of certainty that we're all pre-qualified for unconditional love and remembrance of what we are. Radiated that every moment of her life, without exception, without break, seamlessly. You can't do any more than that. That's the most anyone can do. And there was nothing else that you needed to do. Nothing else that anyone needs to do. Because this is already the situation. We're in this situation. We keep thinking that it's not yet here, it is already here. We're literally in this situation. We've always been in this situation. The realization, the final realization, is that we never have needed to do anything. No one has ever needed to do anything. There are many who have tried to disqualify themselves from this so they could feel more stable in their pretense of being Prime Creator. Of course, how else can we feel stable and try to feel certain about that we're Prime Creator unless we feel that we're disqualified from experiencing this unconditional love, which would remind us of what we are. So of course there have been many who have been great villains and villainesses throughout history, trying to disqualify themselves from this because there's this nagging feeling of something's inside that's going to blow all my pretenses away. Really? I mean, you see people doing wicked things. The fact is they're trying to disqualify themselves from this experience so that they can get this ego trip of being Prime Creator. They're trying to do that. That's the only way they can really do it. And the other way would be to say, be on the trip of, I'm working really hard to qualify myself. That's still an ego trip. Same ego trip, really. You know, one can, they've been disqualified from it, or one can feel that they're qualified, but it's going to take them a million years one feels that they're potentially can be qualified, but it'll take them a million years, you know, but they think, yeah, this is great, I'm all in line with this, I agree with this and all, but it'll take me a million years. Well, what's that? It's a million years of ego tripping, isn't it? So one says, well, a million years in the future, I'll get it, but right now, what am I? Well, I can pretend to be Prime Creator. It's the same game. Maybe saying that I'm disqualified, you know, it may be a little more severe as possible. I'm not sure about that, but it's possible. Just to completely try and say I am definitely 100% disqualified because I'm doing all these terrible things. I'm acting out in a brutish, you know, way. and we're just I'm in wallowing in depravity, therefore I must be disqualified, therefore I can pretend to be prime creator and nothing's going to interfere with that pretense. Yeah. The world is headed in that direction, to tell you the truth, and there's no reason why we shouldn't tell the truth, right? The world is really, really headed in that direction. There are those who want so desperately to continue their pretense of being prime creator that they are willing to work very diligently towards disqualifying themselves. And they are doing just that. They have been doing just that. This world, they see this world as a great opportunity to disqualify themselves. And that's what they're setting this world up for. They relish it. They say, oh my gosh, this world is incredible. Look at all the ways we can disqualify ourselves. For them, it's almost like paradise. Hell is like paradise for them, almost. Because it enables them to go on this severe ego trip of forgetting what they are, of feeling that they're disqualified from experiencing unconditional love, and therefore believing that they are prime creators because they can't remember what they really are. You see how that works? And this world affords them an enormous opportunity to do that, and they flock in here. They flock in here the way that you know what attracts flies, you know. They sense it, they feel it, they say, oh wow, what an ego trip we can go on here in this world. We can be really bad here. And for them, that's great, because that gives them the feeling they're disqualified, which means, hey, there's nothing within me that is calling me back to remembrance of myself. There's no means, there's no way to do it. Therefore, I don't know what I am. I've permanently forgotten what I am. This is what I am right now. I'm prime creator. That's how it works. So literally, I'm telling you straight out how it actually works, how existence works. If you see it this way, the world is not baffling at all. You're not baffled by it. Why are these entities swarming into this world and engaging in, you know, oh my gosh, all sorts of things. Being very clever at it. Being very ingenious at it. Being very dedicated at it. Being very inventive at all sorts of forms of depravity and wickedness and violence and schadenfreude and you name it, whatever it is that makes them feel, ha-ha, I'm disqualified. I disqualified myself. They boast about it, really, honestly, right? Isn't that true? It is true. There are some in the world who are becoming very boastful now. They go out and they boast that they're wicked, they're terrible, and they feel this is like a great accomplishment. And from the perspective of the ego, it is a great accomplishment. And they don't see anything wrong with it because they're looking at things from the standpoint of the ego. They feel they've made extreme progress, and the rest of us are fools from their perspective. You might wonder, why don't the, for instance, the reptilians have any mercy on this planet? Because they look at us as fools. They really do. They look at the quote-unquote religious people or spiritual people as absolute fools, knuckleheads, because they're not making the most of this opportunity here to disqualify themselves. I can't believe it. They say, what do you mean turn the other cheek? What do you mean forgive everyone? What do you mean love everyone? What kind of nonsense is that, they say? Here, we can come here and we can exploit everyone. We can plunge the world into disasters and wars and conflicts. We can do all sorts of sinister things and enslave people and treat them with disdain, and we can do all these things. And what a great opportunity, they say. And how come you religious people are not doing that at all? Well, what a waste of time, what a waste of breath. You shouldn't even be here. That's literally their attitude. And they're becoming very, very direct with this attitude now. Expressing it openly, with no shame, shameless about it. Because they're looking at the situation from the standpoint of the ego. From the standpoint of the ego, what they're saying is logically plausible, you see. There's logic to it, from the context of the ego. And that is, the ego says you can be prime creator, but in order to do that, you must not remember what you really are. And therefore, you must avoid remembrance, the means of remembrance of what you are. You must avoid it. And therefore, you must somehow disqualify yourself from it. And therefore, you must act in these crazy ways to disqualify yourself from it. And so the more these people act in wicked ways, the more they feel they're disqualifying themselves, and the more they feel then that therefore they can become prime creators, which they say is, you know, a great thing. They'll be wonderfully happy and blissful when they accomplish this. So there is a kind of logic to it all. The ego's logic is consistent with its premise. You see, make no mistake about that. It's not that these people are illogical. Not at all. It's that they have a false premise. But really, there is no mercy. When those who are wicked, they view others as deserving of being treated, ill-treated, deserving of this, because they're foolishly not making use of the opportunities. It's that kind of thing. They deserve to be trodden underfoot, because what fools, you know, subhumans, what fools. They're not making use of their opportunity here. Disdain, the ego disdains that. Those who are not trying to disqualify themselves, the ego disdains them. And the ego will offer them an olive branch and say, well, if you just work hard to qualify yourself, then I won't disdain you quite as bad. You know, you'll get a little bit of status. You're still foolish, but you're not completely insane. Whereas the one who does not work towards qualifying themselves at all, the ego says that one's completely insane. So, from the standpoint of the ego would view this one as completely insane. Because you're not trying to do anything to qualify yourself, and not trying to do anything to qualify anyone else. Just reminding them of the fact that they're already qualified. So the ego would say, this is complete insanity. Total insanity. Now, if she were born in a place like modern day America, for instance, the educational and social acculturation system would say that she's completely insane. And they would medicate her. They'd give psychiatric evaluations. They'd claim some type of severe autism, or make up some other category, some type of severe affective disorder, and give all sorts of medications and drugs and therapy, etc. But she was born in a very small, little farming village in Bengal. Almost on the border of what was then Bengal and what became East Bengal. Very, very much rural, extreme rural situation. Didn't even hardly attend school. There was maybe some little primitive school where they taught, you know, maybe a little bit of writing and a little bit of reading and some arithmetic, maybe a little bit. Yeah, she didn't really attend. Nobody cared about it. Nobody bothered about it. And some people would say that she's maybe a little crazy, but they didn't mind. because it was a good craziness. Because she would tend to just sit still for hours on a time, like a statue, and not seem to be about fashioning a life, really. Because she realized she didn't have to do anything, nothing that she needed to do otherwise than radiate certainty to everyone. But in this day and age, can you imagine someone who merely, as a child, simply sits stone still like a statue, unblinking, and simply radiates this certainty without any motivation to do anything or go anywhere or be anything or make anything of their life? Can you imagine that would freak everybody out? Everyone would take it as a challenge. Say, oh boy, we've really got to help this one qualify, because this one seems like they're going to be severely left behind in our great effort to qualify ourselves, you know. That's really the attitude, is that we take pity. We say, oh my gosh, how are we going to teach this one how to qualify for unconditional love? Because they're not making any effort towards it. It would cause a panic, wouldn't it? The educators wouldn't know what to do. The mavens of culture would not know what to say or do. What do we do with this one? But at that time, in that place, there were many wise ones who said, wait a minute. Hey, this is what we've been waiting for. We can tell that this one is radiating perfect assurance of our, that we're pre-qualified to experience unconditional love. They picked up on it. And so, from that standpoint, she began to attract many who would just sit silently and just, observe and feel it and say, is this really true? Is it really true we're pre-qualified? And they'd come away saying, deep down they think, maybe I am pre-qualified. And that's a start. But how far have we drifted away so that they're in this world now, we don't even recognize someone like this as being valuable? We're not even searching for it. We're searching for someone who has a resume of qualification. We're seeking for someone to manage to get rid of all sorts of problematical situations. They manage to qualify. They manage to find a way to qualify, we think. But no, that's not it. No one can qualify because we're already pre-qualified. And no one has to go out and qualify others. Now, of course, the world is based on systems of qualification. And in trying to get rid of disqualification, so to speak, that's the good part of the world, so to speak. The quote-unquote bad part of the world, the dark side, is trying to disqualify itself. So in existence, you have the so-called the light and the dark. The good side, the bad side. I tell you the truth, they're both the same. Because they're both accepting the notion of qualification. One is trying to qualify, the other is trying not to qualify. But they're still accepting the ego's context, kind of refusing to look at it from the standpoint of reality. And reality would say everyone's already pre-qualified, nothing has to happen at all in existence, except everyone simply choose to experience this unconditional love, this remembrance of what we are, this overlay, this perfect overlay of everything in existence. With no conditions. That's all we have to do. That's all that the Prime Creator conveys to us. That's it. And it's not that the guru is simply radiating this unconditional love to us. We may think the guru is doing that for us. That is, the value does not lie in that. The value lies in the fact that we recognize the guru is radiating this to everyone. Therein lies the value. Consider this very, very well, if you can hear this with open ears, because you know that we have a tendency when we meet some being that is radiating this perfect assurance to us, that unconditional love is there for us to experience, that we can look at this one as feeling as if they are seeing us as special, and that we have a special relationship with them. Not true. Not true. We're missing it. When we look at it that way, we're going to miss it. We're going to bring something about which is not the intention of this type of teacher, this true teacher. But when we see it, that this one is radiating assurance to all equally, that is when we are truly assured and we get it. So we don't even need to be concerned of how is the teacher relating to us. You know, me. Does this teacher looking at me? No. How is the teacher relating to others? How is the teacher radiating assurance to all the others here? And if they're radiating it to all the others, you see, then that's the assurance we need. We realize they're all pre-qualified. That means I'm also pre-qualified. It means I don't have to do anything to qualify these other people. You see how that frees us? That's what really frees us. It's the wise one in the corner who seems to be very humble and meek, and what they're really doing at the satsang is they're seeing, is this assurance radiating out to everyone equally? They're not even thinking about themselves that way. Is it coming to me? Is it coming to me? No. Don't care about that. That's the least of their concerns. It's not where their focus is. Because they, in the back of their mind, they're thinking, I wonder if everyone is pre-qualified or not. Because if they are, I'm free. And if they're not, I'm not free. So is this teacher really giving me assurance of my freedom? And in order to do this, we have to see that they are assuring everyone equally. The quality is there. No matter what they say, the assurance is there. So in this case of a Sri Anandamaya Ma, she radiated this to millions and millions in India, and some that came from other places, equally to everybody. So it was massive, this massive reassurance, this massive assurance was given out, which is a tremendous witnessing for us. And we can say, wow, if everybody that she met over there was given this perfect assurance, then it's very likely, you know, that I don't have to qualify anybody. They're all qualified. Now, it might be better if there had been more assurance being given out to different peoples all from all over the world, because the ego will always say, wow, those people were Indian, and maybe they've got some special deal with God, you know. So the ego can always play that card, you see. It's a weak card to play. Because she didn't give any differentiation among any of the Indians at all. And there were foreigners who came too, and same, no differentiation as far as assurance goes. There were caste rules that had to be followed, etc. But that has nothing to do with the attitude of assurance. The problem is that anyone that comes in this world will belong to some race, some peoples, whether it be multiracial, whatever. They're all going to belong to someone will claim them for their own, you know. And then having claimed them for their own, that someone will feel that they're special. Okay, that happened with Jesus, right? There's some that claim Jesus for their own. Says Jesus is ours. And then others feel left out, you know, and they say, well, you can come in and join this, but he's ours, he belongs to us. Well, that ruins the witnessing, doesn't it? It misses the mark. The whole purpose of Jesus was to say, I belong to everyone. My assurance extends to everyone through all eternity that everyone is pre-qualified. And some will say, well, someone appears in either a male or a female, and they will say, well, this person belongs to this gender or belongs to that gender. Like they will say in this case, she belongs to us. You know, she really came to help us, to help females and give us the assurance. And then therefore that becomes unequal assurance, right? Like somehow we're more qualified than others. And one can also say that there's some who feel that they're not pre-qualified, that a teacher will come and help that group realize that they too are pre-qualified. You can look at it that way also. There are various ways to look at it. So it might be that women at the time felt that they were not pre-qualified, and that she helped them feel that they were pre-qualified. They call this, psychology calls it self-esteem, so to speak. But that gets to be a bit tricky, really. Because how did one get the feeling of being disqualified in the first place? And the answer to that has to be, and hear this very well with open ears, that one wanted to engage in the pretense of being prime creator. So be very careful when you claim victimization, when you claim special status, that you've been somehow beaten down and felt that you're not qualified to experience unconditional love. Keep in mind this can only happen when you yourself desire to be prime creator, desire this pretense for yourself, and therefore you have tried to disqualify yourself, tried to believe that you were disqualified from experiencing unconditional love. So there isn't really any way around that. Very careful about this. The world has slipped into this mistake big time. That there are those who have been victimized throughout history. That's what the world is saying, that there are groups that are, you know, been victimized. If you look at this carefully, you'll see that any group, anyone that has feeling that they somehow have low self-esteem, that they're not qualified to experience unconditional love, and they've been discriminated against, etc. The only way this is possible is if those must want to experience being prime creator, want to experience that pretense, and therefore they've tried desperately to believe that they're disqualified from experiencing unconditional love. That is a fact. So we have to, from the standpoint of reality, you see, this is true. From the standpoint of the ego, no, the ego will say, oh no, you know, other people caused you to be disqualified. Nothing you did. You were victimized. Not true. Again, the universe pursues the belief in disqualification adamantly. That's the ego's utmost importance on the ego's agenda, is to believe that we're disqualified and to pursue that, to pursue wickedness, to pursue stupidity, to pursue lowliness, to pursue anything that will make us believe that, hey, we're disqualified, and then we'll think, aha, now I can believe that I can be prime creator. So it's spiritual pride that is generating all victimization. That is a fact from the standpoint of reality. That is a fact. And when we see that, we'll say, okay, that is so. But if we drop the desire to pretend that we're prime creator, we don't have to try and distance ourselves from experiencing unconditional love, which reminds us of what we are. We don't have to distance ourselves from that. So we don't have to be victimized. We don't have to have experiences which make us feel disqualified. We don't have to do that anymore. We're through with that. And we could admit, yeah, in the past I set myself up for experiences which would cause me to believe that I was disqualified. But now I see it was my own desire to experience being prime creator that led to this situation, this suffering, this misery, this all this discrimination, etc. That's what brought it about. I actually was completely complicit in all of that. And the wise ones get to that point and they see it. They say, I was really complicit. That's true. No harm, no foul. I mean, that's just a fact. You're still completely pre-qualified, right? You cannot disqualify yourself. That also means you can't be prime creator too, you see. So we're dancing around this here, bringing a lot of threads into it, right? Different dance partners, same song. We're bringing in these different dance partners. So victimization, discrimination, low self-esteem, these various groups claiming the teacher for their own, saying, a teacher, you know, we feel that we're disqualified and it's not fair, it's not right. The teacher will say, okay, you feel this way, that needs to change. But then what happens is the group will say, yeah, but some other group, they caused us to be disqualified, and now they need to be punished for that, you see. And there you go, you've lost the thread of truth right there. Because again, everybody is already pre-qualified, can never be disqualified, so how can you punish anyone? You can never take that away from them. The truth cannot be taken away from us. So how can we really be punished? We cannot. So therefore, the wise will simply give up vengeance. They realize it's futile. They can never take away the fact of truth from anyone. The truth that they are already pre-qualified in love, unconditional love is right there, present for them right now. Can never change that. So the wise have to begin forgiveness starting with themselves. Forgiveness begins with forgiving ourselves for trying to disqualify ourselves and blaming somebody else for that. Really. As long as we're playing the blame game, we still believe in disqualification. As soon as we say, you know what, I wanted to experience being prime creator, so I had to try to disqualify myself from remembering what I really am. So I did everything I could to try and disqualify myself. I made certain that I entered into all these horrible experiences. And of course, there were others who also wanted to disqualify themselves who participated in it with me. Yes, of course. But it was my desire to disqualify myself that caused all of this. As soon as one looks at it that way, the doors to paradise open up. No more blame. No more blame game. No more effort to disqualify others. No more effort to judge others as what level are they at. No more effort to bring someone down a peg. And simply a turning towards this experience. Experiencing unconditional love and realizing that we had it all the time. Everybody has it all the time. We were just playing silly games, beating each other up, hoping this would disqualify us. If you're very sensitive, you have experiences of other people really literally begging you to victimize them. You know, and you say, no, I'm not interested in that. And they'll say, oh, come on. You know, punch me, as it were. And you kind of might be shocked. Say, wow, this person really wants to be victimized. Why? They wanted to be poorly treated. Why? And then you know, you realize, they're really on an ego trip. They want to be prime creator. And this, they feel, is going to help them get there. And you wonder why people put themselves through such misery. And you know, some therapists, astute therapists, will tell you, you know, hey, these people, they want to suffer. They keep putting themselves through suffering and misery. Why? Because of this. They want to be prime creator. They want to experience being prime creator. They have to try and disqualify themselves from remembering what they really are, which would remind them they can't be prime creator. It's that simple. And the way to do that is to try to disqualify themselves. And the flip side, also the way to do it is to constantly be obsessed with trying to qualify oneself, which is another type of suffering that therapists see, as people come with this flip side, is this obsession and compulsion, and they just, you know, working constantly, working so hard, and they're burning themselves out, and they just no happiness, and you see these very intense people who just are miserable because they're trying to qualify themselves, which is another way of avoiding realization that they're already pre-qualified, you see. Those types. So therapists in this world are trying to improve their understanding. That's which is why many took a course in miracles and are working with that. But there's and so hopefully they will. Hopefully this video will help some therapists. Because a lot of good work, therapists have done a lot of good work. They have, and they're trying to get to the root of it. And in my case, I was fortunate to come across a great teacher such as this one. And why was I fortunate? Because I was willing to really put the focus in on it. And was willing to had the necessary discipline and perseverance and intensity to put up with the, you know, severity of the situation. And the severity of the situation is that she never wavers from complete assurance. And you don't really know how to deal with that at all. Very difficult. Most of us, let's be honest, most of us look for teachers that are less than perfect, you know? It's much easier for us. Much, much easier. Because then we can simply ignore the entire situation of qualification, pre-qualification. We just, that doesn't become our central focus at all. Our focus becomes, how do we qualify? And so we really haven't tackled the ego at all. This is the honest truth, and there's no need to put any varnish on it, you know. We really avoid tackling the central problem at all. We avoid it if we find teachers that are less than giving us perfect assurance. We really have an out that way. Now with this one, there was no out. There's no out. I couldn't find any out, you know. This is unbelievable. Just what do you do? What do you think? A steady state. No wavering. So the ego simply cannot account for that at all. And therefore you have to look beyond the ego. You see? So it's extremely beneficial if you happen to come across a perfect teacher. Teacher giving perfect assurance. Is that, that's what a perfect teacher is, one that gives perfect assurance that we're all pre-qualified. That's all it means. It's not that they're claiming they're special, they're higher than us, they're not claiming they're God, okay? None of that. They're just giving us perfect assurance that we're all pre-qualified to remember what we are, which is spirit, which is quote-unquote the Son of God, which is the prime created, not the prime creator. That's a real, when we come across a perfect teacher, then we have to tackle the ego. We have to see the whole situation as it actually is. We have to get to the root of it, because the ego has nothing to say with this. The ego can't explain it. It just says, I can't explain it, man, forget it. I said, well, wait a minute, whoa, what do you mean forget it? And the ego says, well, you know, I don't know, sure, she's fine, but, you know, like, what can I say, forget it, I can't figure it out, so let's move on. I said, whoa, wait, Wait a minute. Let's not move on so quickly here. I mean, seems like there's something here that needs to be understood. And the ego just, not interested. You know, not interested. Come on. Let's get back to work qualifying ourselves. And so I might say, okay, I need to at least, you know, do some work here. Let's keep working to qualify. But in the back of my mind, I'm saying, this really isn't getting the job done, you know? It's just, I don't feel like I'm getting it. Not getting it. Why? Because there's nothing to get. Except that there is nothing to get. We're already pre-qualified. That's all we need to get. We don't need to do something to get that. The ticket's already with us. It's not like we say, yeah, we're pre-qualified, but where do we find this? It's already with us. Everything is already pre-qualified. It's with us right now, this very instant. And so, what room is there for the ego to operate under those conditions? None. So the ego will say, well, let's go find another teacher. You know, let's go find someone else. Yeah, well, there are other good teachers as well. But the ego won't be happy there either. So the ego will say, there's no room to operate here. Forget it. But we can say to the ego, you know, no, ego, no. This, you're just the result of my own desire to pretend to be prime creator. It's you're just lying to me because that's what you got to do. I don't have to listen to you or believe you. All the ego can do is advise us somehow to avoid experiencing unconditional love. That's all the ego can do. Advise us how to do it. Trick us, you know, try to trick us. Say, hey, go this direction. Turn away from this one. That's all the ego can do. Can't do anything else. And when you see one that has perfect assurance, what can the ego say except, hey, turn away from this one. Or falsely label this one. Say this one belongs to us exclusively. Or some other nonsense, you know, which then denies that they're radiating perfect assurance to everyone. But there's a denial of that, isn't it? When we say that someone, yes, someone is perfect, but they belong to us, and there's some exclusivity there, we're denying that they really are perfect, giving perfect assurance. Because we're speaking on their behalf, saying that they see that we're pre-qualified, but that others aren't. That others have to qualify. And that completely nullifies their whole purpose for being here. So the ego is very clever at that. Very clever. And we're very foolish. Let's be honest. We're very foolish. It's not that the ego is so clever. It's that we're very foolish. This stuff is really very simple. But as long as we want to pretend to be prime creator, it's like we're drunk. And we're extremely foolish, and we pretend we don't understand any of this. Like, oh, this is real difficult, esoteric stuff, you know. How can we understand it? Nonsense. To the one who's inebriated, deeply inebriated, the one who's walking surely seems to be incredible. Like, whoa, you're Superman, you know, Superwoman. How can you walk a straight line? That's unbelievable. No, and we say, no, it's not difficult at all. It's completely normal. It's you're the one who's so inebriated you can't do it. It's not that I'm anyone special at all. It's ridiculous. It's like that. People, if you realize the truth, people will say, oh, you're absolutely incredible. It's amazing. You know, you're just this most amazing, incredible being possible, and you're so great, and they try to idolize you, all this stuff. They're just denying their own foolishness is what they're doing. What they're doing is saying, we're really, really sharp and clear, but here you are. You're way beyond us, so you're incredible. Not true. Not true. There's no such claims being made. It's that the ones who are saying that are really in a state of extreme silliness and folly. So much so that they can't see just a simple, simple truth. They're not looking at it from the standpoint of reality, which is what we have to do. From the standpoint of reality, it's It's totally simple. From the standpoint of the ego, it's not understandable at all. The ego can't understand remembrance of what we are because that's not its purpose. It cannot understand what's not its purpose. Its purpose is to advise us to stay away from that. So from the ego standpoint, it has to be bad. Because it doesn't serve the ego's purpose. It's not in alignment. The ego will claim this is out of alignment. It's not aligned. Of course it's not aligned with the ego's purpose. The ego's purpose serves the idea of trying to be prime creator, for spirit trying to be prime creator. That's the ego's purpose. That's what it serves. And it only sees what aligns with that. And if it doesn't align with that, the ego will say, this is misaligned. This is off the tracks, misaligned. That's the ego's perspective. So the ego will claim that this teacher, she's misaligned. She's trying to lead us someplace that's very bad. She's not in alignment with, quote-unquote, God's purpose, meaning the ego's purpose. But this one is aligned with God's purpose, the Prime Creator's purpose, which is to give us perfect assurance that we're pre-qualified to experience unconditional love and remember what we really are, that we're the Prime Creator, we're Spirit. Perfectly aligned with that. And truth and lies are not the same. They don't have equal authority. One is true and the other is not. So the ego's claims, this is misalignment, is a lie. It's aligned with the idea of not trying to be prime creator, whereas the ego is aligned with the idea of trying to be prime creator. So this one is not claiming that the ego is misaligned. It's simply saying that we have to choose a new idea. Okay, it's important. We're not attacking the ego and saying it's misaligned. The ego is aligned with its purpose. No one's denying that. No one's trying to change that. But its purpose is an idea of denying reality. And that idea can never be true. Reality can never be changed. Can never be changed. It can be denied, but it can't be changed. So the ego is telling us that it can be changed. So in that sense, the ego is mistaken. But it's not out of alignment with its purpose. But mistakes have to be corrected. That's our job. It's not the ego's job to correct mistakes. It's our job. So we have to correct mistakes. So we're the ones who have to say, I was mistaken to think I can change what I am. So the ego's not really involved in this at all. We don't need to change the ego. The ego can't change what it is. Can't change its purpose that it serves. The ego is in alignment with the purpose that it serves. It gave rise to it, the idea of trying to be prime creator. We can't change that. Cannot. So we need to simply look at everything from the perspective of reality. It's a choice. The ego will be there if we want to go back to that. The ego will, we can go back and listen to the ego, and the ego will align us with it, try to align us with its purpose. Very basic, very simple. But from the standpoint of the ego, it's not very simple. It's all very difficult. All very, very avoidance, eternal avoidance of unconditional, pre-qualified love is, the ego says, boy, that's really going to be very, very difficult. Yeah, have pity on the ego, because what a job it has, huh? Eternally trying to turn us away from what we want. Have pity on the ego, you know. Have pity on the mind that has to do this. Choose a new idea and choose to experience unconditional love and be reminded of what we really are, and realize that everyone's already pre-qualified and nothing has to be done for this to be true. It's already true. And then simply abide in this realization and the perfect stability of unconditional love. Abide in that. Simply abide in that, as the great teachers have, the great reassurers have. Don't even need to call them teachers. What they're really doing is they're assuring us that this is so, that this gift is here for us. That's all they're doing. They're just assuring us of this fact. They actually don't have to say anything. Their purpose is to assure us that unconditional love, we're all pre-qualified for it. And they can do that simply by sitting there silently without saying anything. And then radiating this assurance to all without exception, without qualification, without judgment. Just can actually literally be just silent, and then we just can pick up on this. So they don't really have to say anything. And they can say in comment too, of course. Doesn't change anything. Either way. Satsang is a lot of fun, isn't it? You get in there. You get in the ring. It's pretty lively in there. You know, there's a lot of ideas are flying here and there. The feeling should be one of fun. This is fun. This is really fun because we're really grappling with stuff. We're really grappling with some really amazing dynamics here. Coming to terms with what needs to come to terms with. This is beyond high level negotiations. You know, that's the truth. The fact that you're listening to this, you're more fortunate than anybody who's engaged in any negotiations in any place in the world as far as political negotiations, you know, negotiating peace, negotiating war, negotiating economics, banking problems, business situations, personal relationships, all this negotiations that are going on in the world. You're actually participating in something that's way, 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 way beyond that. We're seeing what the terms of peace really are, and that we're seeing that there are no terms that we need to come to, except to realize we already are pre-qualified, and yet we are engaging in the action of looking at this, of bringing up the opposition, and then dismissing the opposition. We need to do that. I mean, it's helpful. I believe it's helpful. Bring up and say, this is what the opposition is saying. This is what the ego is saying. Okay, now let's look at this and realize that, you know, how to dismiss that. How to see that that has no bearing on reality. Not attack it, but see it. See it clearly. Let's bring it up so we grapple with these, that the ego dynamics, the way the ego looks at it. And we'll say, the ego looks at it this way. But here's the way we need to look at it in order to remember what we really are, which we have to do. Remember that we're not free to become something that we're not. Therefore, the attempt to become something different than what we are has to be relinquished. Okay, that's a fact. No way around that. So we must remember what we are. And we must utilize the means to do that. Have to. And therefore we must see what is discouraging us from doing this. We have to do that. Otherwise we'll continue to avoid it. Where's the avoidance coming from? We have to look at it. Very important. We can't just sit back and say, well, I'm sure I'll do it someday, so I don't need to worry about it. Well, the ego still has full reign in your belief system, and the ego will never agree for you to experience this. So you have to break the spell the ego has on you. And we need to bring up, you know, these things and say, the ego has you spellbound this way. But now let's look at this carefully, and we see, aha, is illegitimate. You see, and that lessens the spell. Lessens it. We're not quite as spellbound as before. And so that's a big part of satsang too. I mean, those who are really advanced in breaking the spell of the ego can theoretically simply go to a teacher who's silent and radiating perfect assurance, and they can get it right then and there. They realize everyone is pre-qualified, I'm certain of it, and they can then experience this. But how do they get so advanced? By bringing up, by lessening the spell of the ego, which is done by bringing up the various spells that we feel bound by and dismissing them, finding out how invalid they are, completely invalid. From the standpoint of truth, they're completely invalid. From the standpoint of the ego, they're very valid. And so that is really what the realization is that we see there's two ways of looking at it. We can either look at it this way or that way. We have to choose. Because if we look at it from the ego standpoint, the ego will seem more rational, will seem logical, more logical than the standpoint of truth. If we choose to look at it from the ego's perspective, will seem more reasonable, logical. But if we look at it from the standpoint of truth, then the ego will seem to be totally illogical, you know, totally unreasonable. Holds what it says is just simply plausible nonsense. So we have to... We're getting to the point of either choosing one or the other instead of trying to change one or the other. It's a choice we're headed towards. Not a change, but a choice. Not a modification, but a choice. Which perspective, which way will we look at it from? The ego's perspective or from the perspective of reality? If we look at it from the ego's perspective, that means we still want to be prime creator. We want to still experience an ego trip. If we look at it from the standpoint of reality and truth, that means we're willing to give up those pretenses. That's all it is. Very simple. And so satsang is the activity of bringing up these spells that we're under and looking at them, which is fun. It's interesting to finally hear this and see it and say, oh my gosh, I've been fooling myself this way for ages, and now I suddenly see it. I say, oh my gosh, that is very pretty, really stupid, very simple. How foolish, you know. It was just a little foolish whim. I just decided to pretend that I was stupid, so stupid I couldn't see it. But now I'm seeing it. That's not difficult. The spell is, you know, loosening the grip of the ego, saying, of listening to the ego's advice is lessening. Remember saying, well, if I want to avoid experiencing unconditional love, then I have to listen to the ego's advice. But if I want to experience unconditional love, then I need to not pay attention to the ego's advice anymore. And we start to see how simple it is. And it's just this really a simple decision, just a decision. That's all satsang is going toward, is a decision. Not a technique, but a decision. Decision to realize that, yeah, everyone is pre-qualified. And therefore, there's nothing I need to do, there's nothing I can do about it. I can't do anything about it. That fact, I can't do anything about it. Everyone's pre-qualified. Even if I hate their guts, I can't do anything about that. I cannot. And if I think I'm trying to wait till it changes, it will never change. So waiting is folly, stupidity. Yeah, I don't really want to be stupid. Nothing I can do about it. Nothing I can do about it. Nothing the ego can do about it. The ego will tell me that it can do something about that. That it can right the wrongs, you know. The injustice of it all. The ego can do nothing about it. Nothing can be done about it. This is a realization that satsang is headed toward. There's nothing, can't do anything about it. Everything is already saved. There's nothing I can do about that. It's already, the universe is already saved. I can't be a savior, it's already saved. I can't go save anybody because they're already saved. And we might pout a little bit over that, you know, because we think, I wanted to be a savior. I wanted to save someone, you know. I can't do it because they're already saved. They were saved. They've always been saved. There's never been anyone to save. We might shed some tears over that and pout a while, but, you know, we'll get over it. We'll get over it. All right. Let's go back to a picture here. And just keep in mind that there have been those in this world who realized and know that we're already saved. Everyone's already saved. They know they're not saviors. They're just reminding us everybody has always been saved from the very beginning. And so there's no need for anyone to keep on pretending that they can save the world, save the universe. It's always been saved. Just need to look at this fact. And looking at this fact, one cannot help be blissful. And of course, in our present culture, not a lot of support for that fact. And yet it is a fact. An unsupported fact, you might call it. But here we are, plugging away at it, realizing that the universe is already saved. Just rest with that realization. The universe is already saved. Nothing for me to do. There's nothing for me to do in the whole universe as far as saving it at all. All I can do is remind the universe is already saved, but there's no function of saving it that I have at all. Never has been. That's a good feeling, really. We'll rest on that feeling. Kind of humorous. Nothing has ever needed to be saved. It's all, from the very beginning, everything was already saved. So what have we been doing? You know, kind of just muddling around, wasting our time. All right. Very great. That's it.